Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of the Health and Sports Committee in 2018. Can I ask everyone in the room please to ensure that their mobile phones are switched off or to silent. While it is acceptable to use mobile devices for social media purposes, please do not record or film any of the proceedings as we have people who do that for us. I can say that, start by saying that members of the committee greatly appreciated the informal engagement we've had with people with experience of suicide in their lives, and that's much appreciated and will certainly inform our views at the end of this session. But our main evidence session this morning, in a formal sense, is also on the Scottish Government's Suicide Prevention Action Plan. And I'm delighted to welcome to the committee Dan Proverbs, the founder of Brothers in Arms, James Jopling, the Executive Director of Samaritans in Scotland, Craig Smith, Public Affairs Officer from SAMH, Toni Giugliano, who is the Policy and Public Affairs Manager for Mental Health Foundation Scotland, and Scott Walker, Chief Executive Officer of National Farmers Union in Scotland. Thank you for joining us, and we all look forward to hearing what you have to say. Questions and answers, as always, through the chair, and we will endeavour to cover the territory in what is a very substantial area of policy. Can I ask to get us started, each of the witnesses, for your view on the extent to which you consider that the Scottish Government's draft suicide prevention plan addresses the recommendations which were made in the suicide prevention strategy report. Who would like to kick off on that one? James, yes, please.
Thank you, Gavina. I mean, we were quoted publicly as saying we were very disappointed with the first draft that was produced by the Scottish Government. Given that we'd waited over 2 years for a new national plan, given that suicide takes 728 lives in Scotland in the last year we have data for, and given that the impact across communities and families in Scotland, we felt the plan needed to do more. It needed to show more ambition, more investment in the kind of resources to support those in crisis care, both before, during and after suicide, and more effort to address the stigma, which can often be deep-seated in communities and families about the issue of suicide. We're getting better, undoubtedly, about addressing some of the issues around mental health and talking and listening more, but there's far more we can do, and we need to address that because Scotland has a higher suicide rate than other countries in the UK, and for men particularly. And that's not business that's been completed. It's not work that's been given the attention it has. We absolutely acknowledge the impact of work done in the early 2000s and the fact that we've seen that suicide rate decline over time. But our worry is, with the increase last year, that we might begin to see a return to where that rate starts to increase. And so that's why a plan at this point is so critical.
Thank you very much. Other witnesses want to add on that general point? Yes, please, Craig.
So kind of similar to James, when the original draft was published, SAMH has taken a kind of hopeful and helpful view on that. We were disappointed with the scope of some of the proposed actions. We are happy to see some progress made. So I know the government announced in the recent debate in Parliament around the final plan will have provisions for reviews of all deaths by suicide, and that's something that SAMH has been calling for a significant period of time, and increased bereavement support. So they're welcome moves in the right direction. I mean, what's really key for us is that the plan is ambitious. So as James said, we saw an increase in deaths by suicide in 2016. While we have to be really cautious about looking at any year's deaths and pay in mind the context of an overall reduction in suicides over the long term, we don't want to see that becoming a trend. So it needs to be a really key focus for government at the national and at the local level going forward. And what we'd really like to see is a plan that has clear, transparent funding, that really restates that link between the national and the local and provides national leadership and infrastructure to implement local suicide prevention activities to build on that reduction of suicide over the last decade. And we are concerned that there has appeared to be a lack of focus or reduction in focus in suicide prevention activities in the recent years. But as I said, we are happy with some of the movements that government has made recently in the further iterations of the plan, but we do need to see that go forward, and we really need to have a clear understanding of how the plan is going to be resourced and transparently resourced in the way forward.
Very much, Toni.
I would welcome and agree everything that's been said so far. The Mental Health Foundation's taken a very clear view about the structures of suicide prevention in Scotland. We think that we need to see a new organisation, a new body set up going forward to drive forward suicide prevention work in Scotland. I think it's fair to say that suicide prevention work has been eroded locally in terms of funding, in terms of transparency, in terms of not having a clear view and understanding of what work is going on, primarily because there is no single organisation that can give us that information, given the diverse degree of work that is happening locally and no oversight at all at any level nationally of what work is going on. So we've been very clear that we need to instil some new ambition, leadership, drive at a national level. And the way to do that is to create a new body that can pursue that, that can work with local organisations on the ground, but also a new body that can be created with, in conjunction with the third sector and organisations that have expertise in suicide prevention, also from a trust point of view, ensuring that the public can trust the organisations that are involved in that suicide prevention strategy, because the reality of the matter is that Choose Life has been perceived as a marketing tool, as a marketing brand, but not an organisation that you would turn to for help. And I think that part of what we need to create going forward is a trusted body that can put new leadership, new drive, new ambition into suicide prevention in Scotland, that can work with organisations on the ground. And that's why we've been very clear to Minister in our meetings that that's what we want to see going forward. Another area of priority that I think we'll hopefully explore at a later stage is, and you've already touched on it, is bereavement. So families bereaved by suicide, and I hope that we'll be able to touch on that in greater detail later on.
Stan.
being somebody that's fairly new kid on the block, I think for me it's fairly simple. It's the recognition of male suicide. You know, there seems to be a lack. It's almost the elephant in the room when it comes to, for me in Scotland, recognising that, you know, 75% of all suicide in the UK is male. And the fact that we as a charity, the only one at the moment that is trying to reduce male suicide, I think says something. Saying that though, I think that the fact that SAMH have put funding into research for male suicide in Scotland, I think is an absolute positive step forward. And you know, it would be amazing to see what we learn from that. But I do think we need to start looking at the fact that men are at risk from taking their own lives in Scotland, especially in the more rural parts of Scotland.
Thank you very much. Scott.
I agree with everything that's been said so far. So, particularly from our area, it's that engagement in rural areas. And how do we have sort of a multi-strand approach that engages with rural areas? So particularly the feedback I get is about that anonymity. It's hugely, hugely important, which goes back to the issue that's been touched on a couple of times so far this morning about the stigma of suicide and the stigma of mental health. And not just for, unfortunately, the people who die from suicide itself, but also the families and the support that's needed to engage with those families going forward. So I think when we look at the strategy going forward, it's looking at not only how do we prevent suicide, but how do we support the families who, unfortunately, are too much affected by suicide? So we get to a situation where everyone can openly talk about it, and we can hopefully prevent people before they get to that issue of crisis.
Thank you very much. I was struck by some of the evidence we've seen around the change in focus or the change in levels of activity around suicide prevention at a local level. My recollection of the early years of the Choose Life network was that it was dynamic and that it had a coordinator for Choose Life in every local council area. I wonder if witnesses would comment on that and on what has changed and why it's changed, if indeed that dynamism has been lost. Toni?
We, through our FOI, Freedom of Information requests, have seen a number of local authorities reducing their funding for suicide prevention. There is no longer ministerial guidance, strong ministerial guidance to local authorities like there once used to be on directing money towards suicide prevention. And I think that that undoubtedly has resulted in some local authorities not prioritising this agenda. And again, some of the FOI information shows that there are great disparities across the country in terms of plans. The vast majority of areas don't have updated plans. Most of them are not strategic plans. There is not a great deal of information about the exact level of work, the detail of work that is happening on the ground. And we've been very clear that we need to use the data. We need to look at the data. What is the data locally telling us about suicide? And are these action plans mirroring what the data is telling us? But again, it's very difficult to know what is happening on the ground, particularly, and I think we're going to be talking about rural issues quite a lot today, and particularly in rural areas, we need to make sure that that data is mirroring those action plans. So we need more clarity on what is being done exactly on the ground. We can't have that clarity, and indeed government can't have that clarity unless we have updated plans. But also in terms of posts and positions, there are some areas that have coordinators that are maybe employed for a handful of hours a week to deal with this. So there are great disparities right across the country. And yes, we need to have local dimensions, but at the same time, there needs to be some national leadership. And if we do have a national body that can provide best practice, that can provide that leadership, that also, and funding is a huge issue as well, where areas are able to bid for funding from a central pot of money to ensure that that funding is not being eroded. If this is purely in the hands of local authorities, we certainly don't have the confidence that in future years local authorities will continue to prioritise suicide prevention funding, which is why we believe that it shouldn't be purely and fully in the hands of local authorities. That's why we need to have a kind of innovation fund, which is something that could be managed by this national body, working in tandem with local areas to ensure that local suicide prevention work is happening on the ground.
James.
Are now is lacking accountability, ownership and evaluation of local plans, and that is different to where things started in 2002. I've been to two local groups or kind of local structures in the last week, one in Glasgow, one in Highland, very different people at each, led by someone from the third sector, one led by someone from the mental health division, different organisations around the table, some first responders, some not. In Highland at the moment there's no Choose Life coordinator. I think it's, you know, the structures worked for when they were introduced in 2002, but what we've lost sight of, as Tony's highlighted, is that sense of, is there a reasonable plan addressing the highest risk groups in a local area? Are we investing in programs to support those individuals? And how can we evaluate what's worked? I mean, when our efforts started in the 2000s and the reduction we saw in suicide, other colleagues of mine from Samaritans looked to Scotland as the model. The inquiry last year by the Westminster government through their health committee identified that 95% of local areas had local plans in place, and there is also a commitment to evaluate those plans. Neither of those things are the case in Scotland, and that's where we need to make up ground.
On from being ahead to being behind, I think.
It feels that way.
Yeah. Okay. Craig?
Yeah, and much of what I was going to say is kind of covered by James and Toni, so just to reiterate some points and kind of key link of funding. So I think what we saw was a change from a transparency of funding back in the early 2000s and that stronger national Choose Life infrastructure to support development on delivery of local plans. When that was lost, when the local funding arrangements changed, we've completely lost that transparency of funding. So like Mental Health Foundation, SAMH have done FOIs to local authorities asking, one, if they had a Choose Life coordinator and how many hours that person worked and what dedicated funding they used for suicide prevention. And less than half of local authorities could give us the answer to those questions. We know there's a huge disparity of activities across the country. So we manage the Choose Life coordinator. So SAMH manages the Northeast Choose Life coordinator who covers Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire. And there's some excellent local work. We've got the development of the Choose Life app, the award-winning app in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire, which allows people to anonymously access information about suicide and suicide prevention, and then get linked into support. But we don't know what's been replicated across the country, and that's a huge issue. So what we would really like to see is that national infrastructure to help local partners develop plans, to share good practice, to have a transparency of funding. So we'd be very keen for the National Leadership Group to be a budget holding organisation that can fund local areas directly, either through an innovation fund type arrangement, or we have learning down in England. So as James was saying, we know that 95% of local areas in England have a suicide and prevention plan or are actively developing one, and they are developing arrangements for evaluation of those plans. But also in England, there's dedicated suicide prevention funding, 25 million over the next 3 years. And part of that is funding is dispersed directly to clinical commissioning bodies against the local action plans. So you have that linkage between activity and funding, which we've really lost in Scotland. And I think having that or a similar model in Scotland where you can really track the funding against activity and having that activity evaluated robustly would make a huge difference to making Scotland a leader again in suicide prevention. And it is very sad that much of the early Choose Life activities that were pioneered in Scotland are being taken up by England and Wales and other parts of the United Kingdom, but appear to have been lost in Scotland.
Dan.
I think, you know, talking from the sharp end, because we deal with the many members of the public who, you know, have experienced suicide, or they wouldn't know who Choose Life is. There's no visibility. And that in itself would tell you something.
Okay. Emma, I think you had a quick...
I'm aware that in Dumfries and Galloway, the National Farmers Union and DNG and NHS Dumfries and Galloway have a wee pilot programme to work collaboratively to look at isolation as well as mental health issues, so the Rural Mental Health Forum. So I think, Scott Walker, if you could just say a few words about that, because I'm assuming that that programme will feed up as a pilot to see how people are working together to address rural isolation and suicide.
Yeah, I think... So starting off with the negative first, then moving on to the positive, is I'm not sure how it will feed up. So it's one of these projects that on the ground is very visible, very well received, and I think hugely important in terms of this prevention, you know, before people get to a crisis stage. But I'm not aware of how that good practice that's happening down in Dumfries and Galloway will actually feed into change that could influence what happens elsewhere, where in Scotland. So we also have initiatives up in Aberdeenshire, which again is working with NHS up in Aberdeenshire, which is that soft engagement with rural communities. So going into rural communities, you know, dealing with issues which, you know, could be as simple as starting a conversation of somebody who's got a back problem that leads into a whole set of other engagement with them, but getting that early engagement wherever possible. So I think you've highlighted what is a very good scheme down in Dumfries and Galloway, one of many different schemes that we have down in that neck of woods. But I think it's disconnected from what could be a national project.
And a quick point on that, and the shared learning is so important. I think there are some models in Scotland which could be adopted, which work really well. So we've got the Children and Young Persons Collaborative work in Scotland and the Scottish Patient Safety Programme, both which pioneer local innovations and then bring people together to disperse that learning nationally. And I think the National Leadership Group for Suicide, which has been prepared, actually could be a really key body in facilitating that shared learning. And there's definitely potential there for that to be built into it.
Alice Cole-Hamilton.
The panel, thank you very much for coming to see us today. Before we convened this morning, the committee met with a group of witnesses in private who are families affected and individuals affected by suicide. I just want to put on record my thanks for their candour and the very moving stories we heard. One of the consistent themes that came out of that was the lack of access to talking therapies, that capacity is such that many times you might visit a GP and the first recourse to action will be medication rather than, because there is no talking psychological therapy intervention available. But also we heard, so the first question I have is, how do we increase that? Where is it working well and how do we replicate that? The second point is that we have when we do have access to talking therapies, there is no continuity of care. We had one really horrific case of an individual who became unwell, and in the 5 months they were unwell before their suicide, saw five different psychiatrists. You wouldn't see five different cancer surgeons. So why don't we have that continuity of care, and how do we change that?
That's a big question, or two big questions indeed. So who would like to start? Talking therapy, psychological therapies, and continuity of care. Who would like to kick off? Toni?
Have a go at it. I think the first thing to say is that psychological therapies, talking therapies, play a crucial role, an absolutely important role in mental health on a wider level. And you touched on medication as well. And I think I would like to say on the record, I think it is important to remember that we should never stigmatize people who are on medication for mental health purposes, for whatever reason. And I think that medication has an important place. It is safe. It works for a lot of people. It's not for everyone. And in many cases, GPs, health professionals will have to have a trial and error experience whereby, you know, you have to see what works for that individual. And I think patient choice has to be absolutely at the heart of this. Professionals and patients need to come to an agreement together as to what the best course of action is for each individual. The problem, and the Mental Health Foundation has said this in the past, is when medication is given, when there is essentially no alternative. And that is, I think, an issue that we need to be honest about. Is this happening? And if it is happening, we need to address it. And we've said before that we would like to see an independent review, not just in Scotland, but right across the UK, of what is happening with regards to the way that the different options, whether it's psychological therapies, whether it's social prescribing, which is very effective for many people, whether it's medication, a review to determine exactly how that decision is made and whether resourcing comes into it. Because if we are in a situation, as I say, where psychological therapies are not the first port of call, and the NICE guidelines are very clear, especially with regards to young people, children, young people, that medication is not the first port of call in most, I mean, they are guidelines, but in most circumstances, medication is not the first port of call, and it should be talking therapy. So we would like to see a review of how we arrive at the decision as to whether it's talking therapies, whether it's social prescribing, and what impact lack of resources is having. But I completely take the point that Alex Cole-Hamilton makes about continuity. It's unacceptable that anyone should have to see five different psychiatrists. You wouldn't accept that for physical health conditions. So quite frankly, it's not acceptable that anyone should have to undergo that that process for mental ill health.
Okay, Craig.
Yeah, so on both aspects of the question, in terms of talking therapy, yeah, we have to be honest, there just is not enough talking therapy. We saw the stats from ISD published last week, and I think it was only one or two health boards met the 18-week target for talking therapies, and that's been a long-term trend. I think that was Ayrshire and Arran that met the target. So there's a huge issue around resourcing for talking therapies. And talking therapies are a really important part of an overall suite of mental health treatments. As Toni has said, medication plays a really important role and can be absolutely crucial for some people. There needs to be a range of social prescribing, activity-based therapies, and talking therapies is crucial in that suite, and there needs to be focus on how we bring those waiting times down and how we increase resources going to talking therapies. I think the other aspect of the question, which is really important, is that crisis care support and that continuity of care, and it is absolutely unacceptable that someone has to keep asking for help from different places, from different people, not getting that help and being pushed further and further into crisis. So we need much better crisis care pathways. There's some work down in England that MIND and the government and the NHS in England have pioneered around crisis care concordats. That's something that SAMH has called for in Scotland. So that's where you have national crisis care standards of what should be expected if you are presenting to anyone in crisis, so any statutory or non-statutory service. And then there's local guidelines, local care pathways that are shared by the statutory sector, so by A&E, by GPs, by the third sector, and someone is placed on that pathway and can get routed into care as quickly as possible. Because what is crucial when someone is in crisis, is they get an empathetic, humane response as quickly as possible, and there is not additional barriers put up, be that in A&E or wherever. So getting that crisis care aspect is right, and that's going to be a really key aspect of the suicide prevention strategy going forward, is that support for crisis services and crisis pathways. But yeah, definitely, it's unacceptable that people, and we hear it often from people using our services, in terms of SAMH, we have done over 500 assist interventions since 2014, so suicide prevention is an absolute key priority for us on the ground, working with people who come asking us for help, but also our own service users. And time again, we hear that experience of crisis support is not up to standard. For some people it is, and it works really well, and there are some great crisis services, but other people are still facing a stigmatized response when they're asking for help, be it with self-harm or suicidal ideation, and that's going to be really key going forward. And It's another priority that the National Suicide Prevention Group needs to really tackle and support local areas in developing a good crisis response.
We did some research last year with people who've experienced suicidal thoughts or lost relative suicide in the Highlands, because there's a disproportionately high suicide rate there. And just very briefly, a verbatim quote as part of that research. Services are terrible, almost on the verge of non-existent. Theoretically, I'm supposed to see a psychiatrist every 3 months, but we haven't had a permanent psychiatrist in post for 7 or 8 years now. We have a series of locums, and I must have seen 8 or 9 different locums in the last few years because they don't stay. They stay a couple of months, they move on. There's no continuity of care at the moment. This backlog of appointments for psychiatry is enormous. That someone is on the Isle of Skye. Just to point out, I know you spoke to people from the Central Belt today, so I mean, it's a very common theme, as others have said. Another thing that we've looked at recently is people knowing that first place to go. What's admirable, and I mean Samaritans has done this work, as lots of other organisations, is encouraging people to talk and listen and mean it when they do so, and we can all do that. But the question is, what happens after that? And if you go to an app or an online resource and you're signposted to somewhere where you might get help, what happens after that? And when we asked a sample of the Scottish population back in April, if someone close to them was experiencing distress or trauma or was in crisis, would they know where to turn to help them? 40% of people in Scotland didn't know where to turn. Now, if it was a physical injury, you'd hazard a guess people could plump for 999 if nothing else. But when it's not that, we're not, those first stages aren't in place, and then after that, where is that continuity into resources? Because crisis in this kind of situation might be something someone goes in and out of over a period of months and years. So we can be there as Samaritans sometimes in that emergency situation, but what happens after that?
Thank you very much. Dan.
I was going to say, as somebody with lived experience, I use medication and I've used talking therapies, and so appreciate that it is out there, but especially for the talking therapy, there can be a waiting list. And of course, if you're not in a position to self-manage, then that can be really difficult. I think something that I think should be part of your strategy is actually a digital strategy, where we use digital technology, as has just been mentioned, in the form of apps and other uses of digital technology to support people waiting for, in those waiting lists, waiting to see the GP or waiting for the talking therapy. And, we've launched our own, and we've had 1,500 downloads in 90 days, and we're reaching everywhere from Stornoway to all parts of Scotland. They're not an answer, but it's part of the support, and I think it's a very easy way, especially for men who don't want to talk about their stuff, where they can download something in private and in confidence. So I think digital strategy needs to be part of your suicide prevention plan.
Thank you very much. And can I pass it to Emma Harper?
Are we going with the targets? Yes. Thank you, convener. Just a really quick question. In the SAMH submission, it says that there needs to be new national targets for reducing deaths by suicide. So I'm interested to know if you think that there's merit in developing a national target to reduce deaths by suicide.
Short answers are allowed on this one. Just because of time, Craig.
Yes, so SAMH do believe that there is definitely value in having a national target. We reflect back to Choose Life, where there was a 20% target and there was a significant reduction. I know there's a debate around targets in healthcare. I reflect on the Harry Burns review, which SAMH took part in, which did find value for healthcare targets. Suicide prevention, we feel, would benefit from a target because it would provide that ambition and drive and focus at a national level, but some caveats around that. So while we very much support a national target, it wouldn't be for us to decide. We're very clear that any target needs to be evidence-based, robust and ambitious. So we would see that as an early action for the national leadership group to come together, to bring experts together, academics, stakeholders, particularly those of lived experience as well, together to devise an ambitious target for Scotland, which can really push resource and ambition in Scotland. A target's certainly not the be-all and end-all, but we think that can help frame. And it doesn't need to just be a simple target. While we would like to see a reduction target, that could be multi-layered, looking at inequalities, looking at the issue of deprivation and the inequality there between the deprived and the least deprived areas. So yes, while we do strongly believe a target has its use, it's not the be-all and end-all, but what's important is that it's evidence-based and robust.
Less minded about a specific target. I think if the ambition is right and it's got compassion and we aim to make sure that no one facing suicide is alone, then we can deliver against an ambition, which I think we can get locally and nationally behind. I think there are so many factors involved in driving suicide rates that I wouldn't want the success or failure of the plan to be judged only on that. Of course, we want to see fewer suicides, absolutely, but I'm less sure that setting an absolute target is the way to do that. I am sure that expressing an ambition, which we're beginning to see the green shoots of since the first draft came out, is the right way to go.
Okay, Toni.
Probably the only issue where SAMH and the Mental Health Foundation may not entirely share a view on today is the issue of targets. We've made it clear to Minister that we would not be in favour of a target. We are not interested in an arbitrary target that may turn into a political football on this issue. Actually, what we need is focus on prevention and evaluation. So we've not had evaluation in suicide prevention in Scotland. Very few countries in the world have had evaluated suicide prevention programmes. It's tough, it's complex, it's difficult, but it's not impossible. And there are countries that have, very, very few countries, I believe New Zealand is one of the very few, that have evaluated suicide prevention programmes, but very few have. That doesn't mean to say that we shouldn't, because unless we evaluate what works and what doesn't, we will never fully understand which programmes work, which programmes don't. We know, for example, that low mood and depression, the identification of low mood and the management and the treatment of depression are effective ways of preventing suicide. The evidence is clear on that. We don't have evidence on many other programmes, and that's why it's time to evaluate those. So for us, the focus is very much on evaluation of what works and what doesn't. It's taking a preventative approach, but a public health approach. So not purely about what's going to be happening in this suicide prevention strategy, but what's happening in our schools, what's happening in our workplaces. That public health perspective to suicide prevention is what will drive, is what will reduce, we hope, the number of suicides in Scotland.
We already have something, which is that 75% of all suicide in the UK is male. So that, for me, is something that we should be looking at and working towards. How do we reduce that? You know, that's where we are when it comes to men and how we cope with our emotions, and what we tend to do is we tend to take our own lives.
Okay. So no specific view on the national target as such.
I suppose just very, very briefly, a target can be a very blunt instrument. and people become focused purely on that figure, that headline figure. Whereas I think listening to the evidence that's been given so far, it does become down to these local action plans, you know, best practice, you know, and targeted evidence seems hugely important. And I think that'd be the way to go forward rather than just focusing on a single figure and a single target to achieve.
David Stewart.
Good morning to the panel. Can I raise the important issue of inequality? Almost irrespective of the type of inquiry our committee do, inequality is such a strong issue. The Samaritans have pointed out that suicide rates are 3 times higher in disadvantaged areas. Does the draft strategy adequately deal with the issue of inequality? Perhaps I could start with the Samaritans.
Yeah, and in addition to that the figure you just quoted, we know that the poorest men in the poorest communities in Scotland have a 10 times increased risk of suicide than wealthiest men in the wealthiest communities. So inequality, you know, is inextricably linked with increased suicide risk. And we did a report recently to look at some of the reasons why that's the case. It's one of the reasons that any approach to suicide needs to be embedded in other key government functions, both nationally and locally, so that we understand that connection. Because not every suicide prevention project has it plastered above the door. You know, projects which are about increasing employability, supporting people who've been out of work for considerable periods of time, supporting those who are in a period of uncertainty around employment. Those are all periods in which we know that suicide risk can be increased, and supporting people at those times needs to be addressed. And it's why it's so important this plan stretches into those other areas of government and speaks honestly about suicide being part of the risks associated with inequality. We think it's critical. We don't see it enough and consistently enough across local plans in how that's addressed. And it's something that certainly we would expect to see and be accounted for in any future plan.
Else? Scott.
I suppose picking up on a point that was said there, yes, inequality is certainly a part of the problem. But I think if I look at rural areas, you know, yes, it's inequality, but it's isolation, and it's also going through that period of change. So if I look at farming just now, we're going to go through a significant period of change. And for people involved in the farming community, it's not just a job to be involved in the farm, it's an entire way of life. It's how people view themselves just now. So with Brexit, with cap changes, you know, a whole period of change is going to be involved there. So I think it's important from a government's point of view that whenever they're looking at policies and how that's impacting upon people is the key bit. How is that going to actually impact on people, and how do you provide those networks, how do you provide the support mechanisms that actually outreach to individuals? And if I look at, say, again, at particularly the farming community, the rural community in isolation, government is one of these areas, say, through agriculture and with rural inspectors, there's a lot of government individuals who connect with farmers, and possibly the only connection on a regular basis with farmers that can be used as that signposting mechanism. So I look at it slightly different than straight inequality, but that access and that rural isolation.
Dan?
Even though I agree with the inequality raising of that, I think actually we've also got to put into what I call the brothers hiding in plain sight. I think sometimes we forget that because of men and how we hide our feelings, we put on a suit of armour, we tend to forget that it's everyday man as well that can be affected by this. You know, it's somebody that can be, to all intents and purposes, be the life and soul of the party and is successful and has good status, but they will still take the same path if they cannot find a way of dealing with their mental health.
Toni?
There's simply no escaping from the fact that people in the most deprived areas are about 3 times more likely to die by suicide than people in the wealthiest communities in Scotland. There's no escaping from the fact that inequalities are more likely to lead to mental health problems in general, depression in particular. And people who experience suicidal ideation are people who, generally speaking, will have experienced some form of loss. So it could be loss of income, it could be loss of a job, it could be loss of a relationship, it could be loss of friendship, it could be loss of pride, self-esteem. And that's why in our submission we've been very clear that we shouldn't just be looking at, and maybe we'll get into the issue of training, we shouldn't purely be looking at the health service and GPs, but we need to look at job centres, ensuring that there is training available in job centres for staff there. Places like Citizens Advice, because debt is a huge issue and we know that financial burdens have a big impact on our mental health. Lawyers, because of breakups and divorce. So there's a whole host of places that we have suggested in our submission that look at training for key staff, not just clinical staff in our hospitals and GPs, which should be core training, but a wide range of staff. We've also, the Mental Health Foundation has also called in its recent report published on Mental Health Awareness Week. We've called for the UK government to conduct an impact assessment on its austerity agenda. We've called on the UK government to look very closely at the impact of welfare reform and the impact that is having on our mental health, and particularly people with mental health problems. Because, again, there is clear evidence that the austerity agenda, as well as welfare reform, has had a huge impact on people's mental health, particularly around employment. And I think employment is a significant area. If you look at the stats, around 70% of people in Scotland who took their own lives were in employment. So it is also about looking at in-work poverty. It's looking at things like job security. We could go on for hours talking about zero-hour contracts, for example, and the impact that zero-hour contracts have on people who are forced to take those kind of contracts because they have no other choice. So the economic and the welfare impact on mental health is significant.
So the wider picture then is, do we understand the social determinants of poverty and inequality? And really, our policy on suicide prevention should be embedded in all policies that governments engender.
I think we can record that everybody agreed with our proposition.
That's probably the first time in life everyone's agreed with that, something I've said.
Thank you very much. Sandra White.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I mean, words I've heard from the panel, hospital and GP, healthcare, national leadership. I want to talk about whole community approach issues in that respect. And over the Mental Health Foundation and their submission had mentioned that, perhaps criminal justice system, workplaces, I think Toni had mentioned it there, and, various other places, schools, colleges, etc. I certainly think it's really important, and some of the evidence that you've been given has. So what role do you actually see, for the suicide strategy and mental health as a whole in schools and workplaces and the criminal justice system, obviously? What role do you see it playing? And should it be, and this is perhaps, I'll throw this in, because we heard evidence of this as well, as I mentioned before, hospital and GPs, health service, but should the monies that's put forward for the strategy and for mental health perhaps be given to either public health or education, perhaps, and that type of thing as well? So I know there's a couple of questions in there, so I'll throw it open to whoever wants to answer first.
James and then Craig.
Just on your last point there, what we know is true in Scotland is of the people who take their own life in Scotland, 25% of them have been to A&E within the 3 months before their death. And of those, 40% were in the week before. So while suicide is a relatively rare occurrence across the whole of our society, there are key opportunities when dealing with people compassionately and ensuring they receive support, not only at their point of contact with health services, but out with that and afterwards, are critical in playing a role in suicide prevention. So absolutely, we need to look at those touch points during someone's life when there might have been an opportunity to change that direction and change that focus. And so it's critical those people know how best to respond in those situations. But wider than that, I think our ability to support, for want of a better word, peer-to-peer support is critical. Samaritans for over 25 years has run a program where we train prisoners to be Samaritans and support other prisoners right across the country, right across the UK, because those people understand best the stresses and strains of other prisoners. And I think we can take that model and those basic skills that we equip prisoners with and ensure that others in communities are too, because some of the best people to understand the stresses and strains you might be facing are people alongside you. And some of the people you might trust to have those conversations might be the people alongside you. So I completely agree. I think this needs to sit four square within the approach of the new public health agency in Scotland. And that needs to be embedded in an approach which looks at resilience and looks at developing compassion in all the engagements we have, both individually and in those more formal settings.
Thank you.
Yes, and to kind of build on that particular last point on public health, so we kind of strongly believe that that should be the kind of locus for suicide prevention. Suicide prevention, as has been said, covers all policy areas and has to and needs to be a focus in education, in health, in justice, in housing, in welfare. Institutionally, we see it should be kind of located in the public health environment because of that role public health plays in health inequalities. We'd much rather see suicide prevention at a local level as well in that kind of public health space, which is developing with the reforms of public health, rather than solely sitting with local authorities or IJBs. We think public health is the best place to get all those different actors around the table and to develop targeted responses. And the wider point about a whole community approach, definitely, we need a multifaceted approach to suicide prevention with strong national leadership and national priorities, but very much informed by local need. You mentioned schools and education. We know suicide is one of the leading causes of death still for people under 25. Schools, colleges and universities have a key role both in having awareness around suicide prevention and having adequate training and having staff that are skilled to support people identifying risks of suicide, which is a very challenging thing to do, and support people in crisis. We need to see this in the context of wider mental health provisions such as school-based counselling, university counselling. But yeah, suicide prevention needs to be key in that. And key is kind of what Toni was saying, and to build on that is training as well. So the new Social Security agency, for example, we'd like to see all staff members trained in suicide intervention training. The wider job centre, the wider welfare service. We know there's an issue still in primary care with GPs having a lack of understanding of mental health and not having any formal mental health training compulsory nature. We see suicide prevention needs to be key in that, key in the role of link workers and the GPs to help route people into support. So yeah, it's a multifaceted approach that's needed, and it always comes back to that balance between a whole population and a targeted approach. And I think that's why we need that balance to made really clear, and a really clear national well-resourced infrastructure to support national priorities, because we know suicide impacts everyone, but definitely taking a targeted view as well. So we know men in the middle years, particularly men in the middle years in deprived areas, as has been said, suffer disproportionately from suicide. We know some of the things that work. We know peers, yeah, that's all right. I'm on full flow.
I don't mean to interrupt, but you know, the last point I made was basically, whilst we put money into the mental health strategy and obviously the health service, should schools and colleges be able to get money from that budget? That's what I mean, rather than it just being in the health budget.
Yeah, definitely. It needs funded across the board. And how that happens could be up to debate. So you could have, as we proposed, the National Suicide Leadership Group holding a budget and could do some funding. We know there's PEF funding for schools at the moment, but we need a more long-term robust funding for mental health provision in schools. If that comes from the existing mental health budget or not, that's up for debate. But yeah, my last point, just to make why I was on a full roll there, was we know there's populations who are at risk, such as men in deprived communities. We know there's things that work. So we know peer support has been said. SAMH runs a Movember-funded changing room project in Edinburgh, where we bring people, Hibernian football supporters together, particularly that group at risk, that men in middle years, to discuss mental health and get mental health awareness and do shared projects. We know some things like activity-based projects, horticultural projects, sports and physical activities have a key role. So it's about having a really wide vision on what is needed to tackle suicide prevention, and that being national priorities, but locally informed need as well.
Thank you.
Much. Before Scott Walker answers, and I know he's keen to answer, I'll bring in a linked question from Kate Forbes, which, and perhaps you can
Great,
address
probably,
them both
probably,
together.
It's to do with the point around targeted areas or the whole population? And there's two populations in particular I'd like to know your views on in terms of how we use the whole community approach to reach them. The first is rural areas. The point was made about ensuring that people who best understand those at risk can actually reach out to them. How can we do that better in rural areas? And the second is around minorities. So minority groups where there might be language barriers, there might be cultural barriers, who they may not use services in the same way. So rural populations and minorities.
Scott. Thank you. And feel free to answer Sandra's point as well.
I think there's a huge consensus breaking out across here. I think public health professionals are very important, so that goes without saying. But for me then, it's looking at the at-risk groups. So who are the key at-risk groups and what are the touch points and how you actually engage with those at-risk groups and who speaks their language, you know, who can engage with them and pull them back, in essence, for a crisis, you know, show them the support that they can receive. So for agriculture in rural areas, one of the successful groups, I believe, are RSABI, which reach out. In the past was in essence a benevolent institution, you know, to help farm workers who'd fallen on harder time, but it's evolved over the course of time, and now it's actually, you know, dealing with not just farm workers but actually farmers and farmers' families who have difficulty, and they're an organisation that can actually engage and signpost people to elsewhere. I think also if we're looking at rural areas and how to engage, you've got to look at people who have the trust in those rural areas. So again, I'm looking, say, from farming and going into wider rural areas, looking at the inspectors from the agricultural department who engage on farms, can see where people have change in behaviour, can signpost them and help and assist them. And you've got to upskill those individuals. And again, here is key about becoming embedded. We talk about a lot about resilience in farming, but we're not really talking all the time about the resilience of the individual. So how do you build that resilience within the individual? Because we know challenging times come ahead. I think you've got networks here around the table who've got some innovative ways of working, and how do they bring their skills and engage that with local community groups? Because there's a whole network of very strong local community groups. So whether you go to Shetland, Orkney, Western Isles, Dumfries and Galway, Aberdeenshire, you need to tailor it slightly differently in each of those areas. And it's given them, I think, the access to the funding, but also importantly, another theme that we've touched on today is that access to best practice. So who can actually go and support those local groups to train them in a way that they can deliver what's actually needed on the ground?
Thank you very much. Brian Whittle.
Good morning, panel. Thank you for coming in. I think even in my short time within this place, the changing attitude towards mental health has been quite remarkable. In that, and there's a long way to go in sort of destigmatizing mental health, but it has already, I think, moved a huge distance. And in some of the evidence we heard this morning, and Sandra White and I heard some quite traumatic and compelling evidence last week at a visit we did, it's very obvious that, and it's touched on by Toni already, that there's a huge diversity in approach in that first instance when we're asking for help. A huge diversity in our healthcare professionals, how they're treated at school, how the justice system deals with poor mental health, how the police deal with poor mental health. And I wonder, and you already touched as well on social security staff needing training, lawyers needing training. Where are we in that? Where are we in that sort of that time frame, if you like? How are we? Because it seems to me, by the time a healthcare professional or a teacher, whatever, gains qualification, they're already out of date. So how do we approach that? How do we deal with that?
Toni.
So Specifically in terms of training, we've called for modularising training. So we've actually called for training to be streamlined and brought together, because there's a whole host of different types of mental health training and suicide prevention training. And frankly, schools and workplaces are very confused about what's what and what's suitable for them. So we've said, and this is something that the new body should look at, let's bring the training together, modularise it, and depending on, you know, the staff members' level of engagement with the public, that will determine the level of training that they would get, essentially. But what we're seeing is that, as a minimum, each organisation should be trained on mental health, first aid, as well as suicide prevention, as well as physical health training. So we want to make sure that we do bring mental health training and first aid training to the fore, in the same way that physical health already is. And to answer your question, we're really nowhere near that at the moment. Health Scotland, in its initial paper, the Scottish Government rather, the consultation paper, it stated that according to NHS Health Scotland, 92,521 people have been trained in mental health or suicide prevention training across Scotland. That's all very well, but this is a lot of this is historical data, and a lot of these people would need to be retrained. So for physical health training, you would need to go through training again after a three-year period. So we would need the same again for mental health. Now, anyone who's undertaken this training, the likelihood is that they will need further training, as you would have with physical health. So it's important that, that process happens. But again, I want to really stress these, going back to Sandra's point as well of the targeted approach, transport workers, lecturers, prison officers, victim support, lawyers, job centres, these are really the targeted places that we really need to make sure, in addition to health services, that we have interventions, that we have trained individuals that can perform interventions where, if and when necessary. And we're not there. We're not there at all. And I think that that's something that should be looked at by the new body, whatever it's going to be called, and whatever function it should have. It should definitely have the function of bringing the training together, modularising it, ensuring that that organisations and workplace, making it easy for workplaces, incentivise workplaces to take out training for their staff, particularly line managers. Line managers are absolutely critical with regard to providing, to creating the working environment, the working space for people to thrive. And I think as a minimum, we need to ensure our workplaces start looking at mental health in the same way they do physical health.
Funny enough, we've been involved in a pilot project with a major retailer, which is doing mental health awareness training with line managers, because they have the direct link with their team. And the idea is to look at their team from a performance. Normally from a performance issue, you if they dip, they'll take them down a certain a performance managing situation. Now what they're trying to say is, if there's a dip, could there be other things out with that? And to give them that awareness of saying, well, maybe there's something mental health or depression or something at home that's... So it's you know, for a major retailer to start looking at that tells you that there's, that's a really good way forward.
Craig.
Just one point on training. We have a slight concern with the draft action as it currently is. So in terms of suicide prevention training, what is really key for us and what we know works from being an assist trainer ourselves and undertaking over 500 assist interventions supporting people in crisis and since 2014 is we really don't want to see that intervention aspect of suicide prevention training lost. What is really key and effective is giving individuals that skills to support someone who is thinking about suicide, may have a plan around suicide, and to support that person to access help and to develop a safe plan. And what we would like to see is assist retained. We know that there is issues around finance of licensing for assist, but we also know that it evaluates excellently. So there's numerous international evaluations of assist training, which show it is a good programme. The Scottish Government themselves did an evaluation in 2008 of assist, which found it was a very effective programme. So we would like to see that retained, particularly for that interventionist aspect. If it is to go, we would like reassurances that suicide prevention training in a new training model wouldn't just be around awareness raising. Awareness raising is key, absolutely key, and there's a huge amount to do around tackling stigma around suicide. And while that should be an aspect of it, what is really key is that the training provides the skills to intervene and provide that crisis support. But yeah, and as kind of Brian was kind of hinted at in his question, stigma is still a huge issue, and that needs to be tackled, whole population, and again, a targeted response. We know that suicide was brought up by people with lived experiences in the engagement piece of work prior to the publication of the draft strategy. We are somewhat disappointed that stigma hasn't featured very highly in the drafts that we've seen of the government strategy. We hope it is implicit in all the work that is planned going forward in suicide prevention. But we know that while there's been significant progress around mental health stigma, and mental health stigma unfortunately still exists, that same progress we don't feel has been made around suicide prevention. And there's particular issues around suicide which are hugely challenging in a stigma terms for people who have attempted suicide and their families.
Just briefly, one point to pick up from your question, Brian, is that there's been a welcome investment by the Scottish Government in a programme of distress brief interventions. So across four different locations, looking to bring together those agencies who most commonly encounter those people with distress and trauma, and making sure those agencies are equipped in how to have that first conversation and do that compassionately, and also that they can refer people on to an immediate programme of support for a couple of weeks to try and help that person deal better with future crises, prevent readmissions or reoccurrences of the same concern. So that, and in Great Glasgow and Clyde, they're looking at a multi-agency distress collaborative, which is a very long title for trying to make the same agencies work together and do it in a more coherent and cohesive fashion. So the kind of gaps that you might have been experiencing, the differences we can reduce. I mean, the important thing is we learn from those programmes and try and embed that learning in a Scotland-wide approach once we've run them for a little bit longer.
Sure, if I could. I mean, it seems to me as part of the issue around how we're managing to bring mental health much more to the fore, and much more into trying to bring parity with physical health, is that we're encouraging more people in this situation to come forward, and we don't have the capacity to deal with that. I think the issue I have is, I know that SAMH has produced some really good literature around accessing physical activity, and Mental Health Foundation have got some really good literature around the importance of nutrition. And what Sandra White and I, we discussed this last week with the group, they know this. These people who are in this situation know that if they're physically active or they have better nutrition, it will improve their mental health. But they still aren't in a position to be able to do that. So in terms of training, it's not enough. Social prescription is not enough to say if you're physically active, have you got somebody to talk to, could you improve your nutrition? It is not enough. How do we make that link? Because to me, that seems to be the most important thing. Because the surprising thing for me was those in that situation actually are aware of what could make them better, but somehow or other that switch is not being switched.
James, do you briefly?
Well, I mean, what we understand about people when they're at a point of considering suicide is about worthlessness and purposelessness. And whilst you can be equipped with all the knowledge in the world about the ways out of the situation you might be in, that doesn't necessarily mean you're able to, in that moment of crisis, to understand and take the kind of actions which you're talking about. And it's during the calls that people make to Samaritans for minutes, for hours, sometimes over a period of time, where it's about listening. And as many of you know, we don't provide advice. It's about listening to someone and helping them find what is the way out of the situation they might be in, and being alongside them during that real challenge. And that requires time more than anything else, and that requires the ability to be compassionate and listen. So. Yeah, there are many ways out of the situations people might find themselves in, and many options available, and we've talked about some of them here, but I think we need to understand that at that point of crisis, it might be that, it's very difficult for someone to see that those are the solutions that might best help them.
Toni.
Very briefly, I think I'll come in on at this point to talk about crisis, because I think we haven't really touched on that, and I think it's important that people receive a compassionate response, an empathetic response when they're in a state of crisis. And from what people tell us, it is not common, it is not uncommon, for people to be in a state of crisis, to go to present to A&E, to wait for 4 hours and be told to visit the GP the next day. This isn't because we have staff that are not empathetic. It's because of resourcing. We don't have enough mental health staff in our A&E units, and I'm delighted that there is a commitment in the mental health strategy to bring forward 800 workers, and some of those mental health workers, some of those will go to A&E. But we need to make sure that if people present to A&E in crisis, and the vast majority of people, whether it's for physical health or mental health in a crisis, will go to A&E. Some will argue that A&E is not the best place for people in a crisis, in a mental health crisis. We certainly would argue that we need to have a situation where NHS 24, for example, if you phone NHS 24, that you are automatically then passed on to staff who can help, who can give you immediate help, or that they will come to you, or that you will be seen in a community setting. But depending on the local arrangement of the health board, and because there is no national framework. But the point here is that people need to receive a compassionate and empathetic response, because if their experience of the NHS is a negative one, they may not go back for help a second time. And it's absolutely crucial that every time that someone is seen, and one of the main challenges is that mental health teams in some situations will not assess someone if they're not in suicidal ideation. So if they're not suicidal, they will simply tell them to go home. That's not good enough. It's not good enough because any mental health crisis, whether the individual is feeling suicidal or not, needs to be addressed. Now, that is what DBI was brought in to do. And DBI, by the looks of things, we look forward to the evaluation of DBI, but unfortunately, that's quite some time away. And there are parts of the country that don't have a system like DBI. And the Glasgow system, the NHS Greater and Clyde Community Triage Service, we think works very well as a system. We would like to see that rolled out in terms of an out-of-hours system as well. We need to make sure that we have a crisis systems across the country that provide a fast response, an empathetic response, and reach people, even if it's people that are known to the system. And that's one of the main challenges. People who are not suicidal, who potentially may be next time, and people who are already known to the system. Those are the two biggest challenges. Mental health staff sometimes will say, well, this individual is known to us, and perhaps in some situations they are not given the consideration and the care that perhaps they should, and that's an issue.
Thanks very much. Dan?
I think the only thing I was going to say is going back to what was talked about in the community, but also in education. I think education has got to be at the forefront. You've got to start getting into the young children, especially the boys, at an early age, boys becoming men, so they build up a resilience so they can cope with the knocks that are going to be ahead of them in the future, so that they can overcome these situations so that they don't reach crisis, because actually that's what we should be doing, is not waiting until they reach crisis before any action is taken. And I think that has to start with education.
Spoke well about crisis and what needs to be done in that crisis situation, which I think is even more difficult to achieve that sort of framework in the rural areas than it is in the, say, the central belt of Scotland. But I then also look at, there was a report by SRUC, which I think picks up very well on the point that you talked about there, where it talks about, you know, people wanting to connect, but at the same time they cannot, for, you know, many different personal reasons. And I think that's where it's that early intervention. So the likes of the Scottish Association of Young Farmers Clubs, they've done a very good, successful, you know, multimedia campaign out to their members, which is about raising awareness of mental health issues and just getting individuals to talk about it. And it's been talked about there, the Scottish Association of Young Farmers Club, you know, there's a pretty even split between male and female members there. But there's been a big focus in terms of getting the male members to actually open up and talk about it, because they're more reticent. You know, there's a greater hurdle, greater barrier for them to overcome those challenges. So for me, yes, we've got to deal with the crisis. Absolutely got to have the right systems in place to deal with the crisis. But if we're going to get the strategy right, it's that early intervention, you know, trying to get as many people away as possible from ever reaching that point of crisis.
Thank you very much. Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I want to sort of develop this point further, because in their evidence to the committee, the Royal College of Psychiatrists said that there must be absolute clarity across Scotland about where people in mental health crisis can go for help at any time. And from the conversations we've had this morning and as a committee, from the evidence we've taken, it's quite clear that at weekends, so many people are failed or are told on a Friday, wait to see your GP on a Monday. So I wanted to know, in terms of the draft strategy as it currently stands, where do you think that can seriously be improved, and what needs to change in that context? Because we've heard, as Toni outlined, what could be done, but it's quite clear it needs to be maybe across portfolio approach, especially around trauma training for emergency services.
Yep. Anyone else want to follow up on that? I think actually we've covered quite a lot of the crisis issue in the answer to the answers to the last questions. James.
One of the things we've welcomed since that first draft came out, and it was attached to the debate in Parliament about the mental health services in Tayside, was a commitment around delivering more constant crisis support for people who've lost a loved one and those affected by suicide. Now, the test of that will be what more constant means, for exactly the reasons you've highlighted. And as I mentioned earlier about our survey, which indicated that, you know, many people don't know where to turn, either themselves or for those they're supporting. So in the country the size we are, that shouldn't be impossible to do. And certainly if you look at things like online resources and where you can direct people from there, it should be possible that even if the resources you end up using are local to you, that there is a way to establish your way into that complex system.
Yeah, just to add to the crisis stuff. So as I said before, and in England, they have a crisis care concordat with local crisis pathways agreed between all partners, statutory and non-statutory. We think that would definitely be a way to go or to learn from that in the Scottish context. There is significant issues around out-of-hour support. And back to the stigma issue, we know that while the majority of people, when they do attend A&E or other emergency services in a mental health crisis, will receive a good response, we know that all too often we are still hearing around people, particularly around issues around self-harm or people who are repeat presentees, with suicidal ideation, not getting a proper response or a compassionate response. And that is really key and needs to change. Kind of like Toni, we've called very strongly for the community triage projects in Scotland, so in Great Glasgow and Clyde, but also Lothian, where you had a mental health professional working directly with the police to support emergency services dealing with people or supporting people who are in mental health crisis. We think that should be rolled out nationally. They've evaluated well. We don't see there should be a delay in a rollout of them. But those care pathways are missing at the moment, and they need improved at a local but also at a national level. And there needs to be an infrastructure for shared learning around that and resourced in place for that as well.
Yes, please.
Just talking about sort of out of hours and then from online resources, I was dealing with somebody, the mother of a 17-year-old boy who attempted to take his own life because his best friend had taken his own life. And luckily there was an intervention, but what was that came out of that, and she was most frightened of and really opened my eyes, is that they found his laptop and every window that they opened was a search for how to take my own life. And for me, you know, 17, that, you know, you can be younger than that. And in fact, I know I've had, you know, emails from mothers of 12-year-olds and 9-year-olds, and the fact that they have access to this material, yet there's nothing online as a resource that sort of balances that out or combats that, I think is something that we need to be looking at.
Alison Johnson.
Thank you. I think the Samaritans in evidence have said there is no longer an effective structure of suicide prevention leadership or delivery in Scotland. So I note the point, no longer. So you obviously feel that at some point there has been. So I'd like to understand what has changed and what you think that leadership should look like. Obviously, for the first time, we have a minister for mental health. I'm just wondering what difference you feel that has made. What would you like to see change? I mean, given that suicide is preventable, but we're still talking about the biggest single killer of men under 50 and young people aged 25 to 34.
Something that I discovered recently, which really struck me along that similar vein, is that if you look at all deaths from all cancers in those under 29 in Scotland, that is a lesser number than all deaths by suicide under the same age. And I think that's a measure of how seriously we need to make sure we're taking this issue. I mean, we've touched on some of the elements which have changed over time earlier in the discussion. In 2002, when Choose Life was first instigated, there was a dedicated national team at NHS Health Scotland who were tasked solely to look at suicide prevention, develop national plans, strategies and support and guidance, and there were dedicated resources within each local authority. Now, the landscape has changed, undoubtedly, but you don't see that same resource. There isn't the same commitment to this specific topic, which is strongly related to mental health, but does not only sit within mental health. And we need to make sure that those resources are aligned and that leadership means something, both at local and national level. As in, who is responsible for a local plan? Is it local authority, IJB, some combination of those things? That's not clear at the moment. And the danger is this is a topic which disappears amongst the good work being done to integrate health and social care. And it's one thing we were very clear and have tasked the minister to show that leadership and make sure that any leadership group which has been discussed has teeth, has the ability to hold the minister to account for what needs to happen in Scotland, and that leadership group has the ability to shape and direct activity locally. Not define what every project is, but using the best knowledge we have available and targeting those groups of individuals we know are at high risk, make sure we're allocating those limited resources appropriately. And there isn't that line of sight through from minister through to what's happening locally. And if we want to hold a minister accountable for whether suicide rate over time goes up or down, we need to make sure there's greater alignment of those resources to make sure that happens.
Okay. Thank you. Is that a view shared by others?
Yes, absolutely. I think we run the risk of no one having real ownership of suicide. And that's not just a problem in Scotland, frankly. It's a problem globally in terms of public mental health and how suicide prevention, how suicide is tackled right across the world. We're seeing that in many other places. But it's absolutely crucial that we don't, as has been said by Samaritans repeatedly, that we use this as an opportunity, as a turning point, to instill that new drive, that new ambition with new leadership. And we can do that. We absolutely can do that. But we need to ensure that we take it out of the current structures. There's no other way of doing it. We need to create a new system, a new body, that can drive forward this agenda in partnership with local authorities and local groups, and have that public mental health perspective.
Very much. Okay. Ivan McKee.
Thank you, and thanks, panel. It's been very very interesting discussion this morning. There was a couple areas I wanted to touch on. The first we've kind of covered to some extent, but maybe just going into a wee bit more detail, and that was around about specific groups, and we know that certain groups are disproportionately affected. We've talked about poverty, we've talked about rural. Men is clearly a huge issue. There's an age issue. LGBT we haven't talked about, but that's obviously an issue as well. Families affected by suicide is an area that's disproportionately affected. So to what extent do you think the strategy should target actions on specific groups? And I suppose following on from that, there's going to be, again, touched on this as well, trigger events within those groups. So it's to some extent possible to target them as to when the issues can arise. So to what extent do you think it should be focused down in that sense?
James?
I think it's a key task for the leadership group, if it's convened correctly and has the ability to influence and shape resources nationally and locally, that they are leading the way in deciding where priorities should lie. I mean, from our perspective, you've covered off where we think the main areas of attention need to be. It's in terms of men, people experiencing disadvantage and how inequality plays across the issue of suicide, those bereaved by suicide and those who've survived it, and LGBT individuals who we know are at a disproportionately higher risk of suicide. We need to make sure efforts we make nationally and locally are targeted specifically to reach the different discrete needs of those particular populations. There are many other elements which can increase your risk of suicide. The only other thing I think we need to make sure that gets national attention are those people who we are not in contact with health services, who are remote and lost to us, and we know from the data are not contacting their GP and not on a mental health drug prescription. There's nothing else that tells us they might be at risk. How can we reach out? How can we use our community insight? How can we develop more compassionate approaches? And how can we reduce that stigma, particularly deep-seated in rural and more remote communities, about discussing suicide at all? Because until you can do that, the challenge is substantial in terms of breaking down the barriers about talking about this issue. So I think that we need to prioritise to make sure the resources are correctly allocated. People will argue about whether they're right or wrong choices, but we need to direct our attention in that kind of focused way.
And then Scott.
I'll focus very briefly on one of those areas, and that's people bereaved by suicide, family members, friends. As things stand, the people that we've spoken to tell us that there is essentially no support available to them in terms of direct support. What we're calling for very specifically is link workers. We believe that there should be link workers available to people who have been bereaved by suicide, who can deal with things like, you know, relationship with the coroner, who can deal with asking for emotional help, psychological help from their GP. We shouldn't be waiting for people to go and speak to their GP following a suicide. We should have a system whereby link workers can offer that support, because we know the evidence is very clear that people affected by suicide are at risk themselves of taking their own lives. Therefore, why do we think it's acceptable that anybody should be on a 12-week waiting list for psychological therapies if their family member or friend has taken their own life and they themselves are vulnerable and at risk? It's completely unacceptable, and that's why we've called very specifically for link workers to provide trauma-informed approaches, trauma-informed support, immediately in the aftermath of suicide.
Okay, Scott.
Yeah, I think nationally, it's all about awareness and stigma. So across the board is raising that issue about awareness and removing the stigma. And then I think you've got to focus on the individual groups according to the local action plans. So look at the local action plans. Give them the flexibility to identify the groups that are most at risk in their area and give them the tools to target those groups in the most effective manner. For me, when I look at the rural areas, there's a big difference between, say, a rural area of Scotland and here sitting in Edinburgh. While the challenges are the same for the individual, how you actually access both, say, the health professionals, your ability to access them are far easier, I would say, in Edinburgh than it is in rural areas, because everyone knows everyone in the rural areas. So you've got that stigma, a greater stigma to come across, where you don't want your business known by everyone else. So I think the point we've talked about before about digital ways of connecting with people is hugely important. Yes, we'll have to get over the connectivity problems that can exist in some rural areas of Scotland. But that's where, again, for me, comes back to these local action groups to sort of say, right, how do we trigger and how do we tackle the people that are most in need in those areas? I think we've got to be aware of trigger events. You know, and that, for me, is about then embedding policy within everything that the Scottish Government or the UK Government does. So we talked about welfare reform previously. That should have been highlighted, where the risk of that could have been to certain groups, and how are we going to tackle it? For me, just now, we're looking at a whole change in the rural support system going forward. That's a trigger event that could cause problems. So how do we prevent that? How do we use the networks that we already have in place, whether it's RSABI, whether it's Scots Association of Young Farmers Club, whether it's NFU Scotland, whether it's the very many touch points that people in rural communities already have, how we build in the capacity within those groups so they can tackle the problems as they come forward.
It's two very specific groups to ask about.
Question I wanted to raise with you, and I'd welcome your kind of professional perspective on this. It was something that struck me reading the papers was every time we talked about suicide, we talked about mental health at the same time. And it was just to get your take on whether you think those two things are inextricably linked or other situations where people will come to the conclusion to take their own lives when you wouldn't say they were suffering from mental health. There's an external factor that causes that, and if you take the external factor away, then those thoughts go away.
Craig.
There's definitely a strong evidence base for a link between mental health and suicide, but I would definitely reiterate that not everyone who takes their life by suicide has a mental health problem. You're at an increased risk of taking your own life. Basically, for any diagnosable mental health problem, your risk of suicide increases. But there's definitely circumstances where people who do not have a diagnosable mental health problem will be in that crisis point due to a whole variety of personal, financial, employment, relationship issues that brings them to a place where they feel they have no other choice but to take their own life. So while I think it is important not to minimise the link between mental health and suicide, because a large proportion of people who do end up taking their own life tragically will have the presence of a mental health problem that has contributed to that, it's certainly not the only factor.
Yes, sir.
I think specifically for men, and you're absolutely right, I think most of it is linked to mental health, but I think for the high statistics for male suicide is because that is our coping mechanism. It's because we can't cope with what life is throwing at us. And ultimately, somewhere, we'll try and do the risky behaviours. We'll use coping mechanisms such as alcohol and drugs or gambling. And at some point when we no longer can, you know, those don't work and we no longer can put that behind us, we then take this other path out as a way we believe is going to solve the problem. But of course, going back to the bereavement, I just wanted to put that in. You know, I get a lot of contacts from families that we do need a bereavement support service, because very often these families, when a male takes his own life, they had no clue. They had no clue. So for them, the shock is just absolutely astronomical, because they will say, because as men, we hide this stuff. And I can give you scenarios where, like 2 weeks ago, young boy at a family gathering, and then suddenly takes himself away and tries to take his own life, and the family's like, well, you know. So I think that's going back to the bereavement support, we've got to put that in place.
Okay, thank you very much. Alec Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Convener. I just wanted to come very quickly in on the issue of crisis support. In many cases, the first line of support that somebody who has either suicidal ideation, self-harm, or is actually attempting suicide will be the police. But we were struck to hear this morning from families affected that actually training on mental health or suicide first aid is only available to the police for those who sign up for it. It's not mandatory. Is that something that we should change and find a way of making mandatory as part of Tolly Allen training?
Craig.
Yeah, absolutely. It should be mandatory for the police, for all emergency services around suicide prevention, and particularly those skills around supporting someone who is in crisis. And we know there is a particular issue around emergency services, and as I've said earlier in the evidence session, around sometimes people receiving a stigmatised response. And there's more that can be done around that. That's, again, why we strongly favour the rollout of community triage nationally. So you have that mental health support and someone who, maybe not on the scene, but someone they can phone for support to provide that advice in that time for frontline staff and frontline police. Another issue around crisis and police is the issue of alcohol and drugs. And we know that's, and not just police, but with emergency psychiatric assessments, we know there's an issue where people have been refused psychiatric assessments because of alcohol or drugs in the system, and that's something that needs to be tackled as well. But yeah, on the point of training, definitely all police officers should have, and custody staff should have suicide prevention training and ongoing suicide prevention training.
Thank you again. And we were also very concerned about the lack of apparent communication between primary care and the police. First and foremost, that police are not always made aware of a mental health situation and they start to process somebody through normal criminal justice channels. But also sometimes police officers are left waiting in hospitals for hours and hours and hours because of their continuing duty of care to somebody who has threatened to take their own life. How do we make that communication between those forces better?
James?
Craig's spoken to it. Earlier about crisis care concordat, which I think is critical about bringing those agencies together who deal with people in those crisis situations at a national level and establishing what those pathways should be, and then that being followed up with action. So there is a way to do that. There is a model in England which we need to look at and see if it's fit for purpose, but there's an approach we can take to make sure that is much more joined up.
Thank you very much. We are pressed for time, so I'll move on to Emma Harper.
Just a quick question, Convener. We've spoke about all the groups that are really at risk, but there's obviously a way that we need to engage children. And there's been an adverse childhood experiences cross-party group formed in this Parliament, and the first meeting is tomorrow night. So, and I'm one of the members that has chosen to join. So I think that is something that will help raise awareness. But the suicide prevention plan needs to have some specific issues focusing on children. So I just... Any quick comments on that?
Yeah, our research published for Mental Health Awareness Week showed that 33% of young people experienced suicidal thoughts in Scotland, which I think is a shocking figure and relates back to the whole resilience programme that we need to look at in our schools. And there's a lot that can be done in schools, there's a lot that can be done at home, but we need to make sure that the curriculum for excellence, our curriculum for excellence, the health and wellbeing strand, is not, as is seen by some may argue, as some tokenistic element of the curriculum. We need to make sure that our teachers are able to deliver it. And if our teachers are able, in order for our teachers to deliver it, they need to receive the training to do that. And the reality is, too many teachers still today aren't able to deliver mental health, to explore mental health issues in our classroom. Be it the big issues that are affecting many of our young people, partly as a result of our digital age, whether it's body image, whether it's a pressure to succeed, whether it's exam stress, comparing themselves to others. These are all big themes that came out in our research earlier this year. And in order to address them, we need to look at resilience building in schools. And as I say, to do that, we need to make sure that curriculum for excellence and health and wellbeing is fit for purpose, our teachers are trained, and our universities are actually delivering the mental health training for our teachers in their teacher training curriculums.
Thank you very much. Briefly, Dan.
I would actually say as well, as part of the education, especially for young boys, 12 upwards, we should be doing it along gender. And I know that, we've got a programme in place called Being Mankind that we would like to put into schools, but we'd sometimes hit obstacles because it's looked at as gender specific. But really, we need to start looking at, if it's 75% of suicide is male, we need to be looking at young males separately and talking to them on their level.
Yeah, thank you very much. Ashton.
Thank you, Convener. I was interested in picking up the aspect around monitoring and evaluation, and I know we've partially covered that already. So it seems from what's been said that we're maybe not doing a good enough job on that. And obviously it's very difficult to know if we're doing, what we should be doing if we're not really sure what we're doing well or what's working. And I think I picked up earlier about this idea about local plans and specifically about them not being evaluated. So I suppose that if we move on to the strategic level, how should we be longer term evaluating the action plan? And in your view, what would that look like?
Okay. We've heard a bit of evidence on that already, but if there's anything that hasn't been said or any witness who hasn't commented on evaluation and what we need to do, James.
There was no formal evaluation of the last suicide prevention strategy. And so it leaves us in a challenging place to identify which of those elements of the programme which we believe underpin that success that we've seen in reducing suicide from 2002 onwards. We need to make sure, as in any would be the case in any discussion about evaluation, it's built in from the outset, that we understand clearly that what the objectives are of the National Leadership Group and how they're actually able to enact them, and we can evaluate then against those and against the ambition we set for the programme as a whole. So I guess it doesn't tell you exactly how to, but that it is a substantial gap in our understanding of how to address suicide risk in Scotland. And it would be remiss of us to enter into what we hope will be a step change in our efforts to address suicide in Scotland unless that was an essential part of the process.
I think we need to have an evaluation framework that is built in from the outset. I completely agree with what James has said, and I think that if we have whatever new body is established, that is something that they can look at and create a kind of framework for local groups to be able to look at that evaluation, what needs to be, what they need to ensure that they deliver, and how that should be independently evaluated, but nevertheless a framework for that evaluation process.
Thank you very much. Finally, the plan in draft, as we've seen it at the moment, has no specific, or is very, I think, fair to say, there's no specific commitments in relation to time skills, and there's no specific commitments in relation to funding and resources. What do witnesses think about that? Should they be in there as part of the plan, or should they be things that develop under the auspices of the plan? Who would like? James.
I mean, the point you've made most clearly is if we want to see the step change, which we believe is the ambition of the Mental Health Minister, we need the resources to build the steps. And as far as we're aware right now, we haven't yet seen evidence of that. And you can look at a number of other areas of government policy. Last year, a commitment to £500,000 pot of resources to address social isolation and loneliness at projects that were developed locally, through to £50 million identified to address the meeting the homelessness targets. So it is not as if there aren't other areas of government where we've made clear and specific resource commitments to areas of real concern. And our belief is that the level of suicide we've experienced, the concerns we have over that one-year increase, admittedly it might only be 1 year and we hope it's no more, mean that we do need to see when the plan is published that there are resources behind the leadership group. Because for them to have the ability to deliver all that we hope and everyone on this panel hopes, they need to be able to direct resources and shape plans effectively, and they need resources to do that.
And does that mean ring-fenced resources, specified resources?
I think there's plenty of evidence to say what we've lost since 2002 by losing ring-fencing is losing that ability, and a number of my colleagues have spoken to that issue. We need a way to do that. We've seen an example again in England where £25 million across 3 years have been identified for local suicide prevention priorities. To make sure this work is happening, we need resource which is allocated to it.
Craig Smith.
Yes, definitely. We need resource and time scales. I'd like to see resource and time scales against each action and a pot for the National Leadership Group to hold to be able to fund transparently local activities. And as James was just saying, that is particularly what we have lost in Scotland. So where we saw the most progress under the original Choose Life strategy is where we had a clear, transparent budget and we had local budgeting that could be tracked, and that has lost. I don't have a figure in my head of what the budget should be, and partly that is due to such a lack of clarity around what is being spent at the moment on suicide prevention. So we need to find out what that is. So we need to have, not an audit as such, but we need more clarity of what is currently being spent. And we know locally we just don't have that details available. And then, yes, ring fencing or not ring fencing, but at least strong ministerial guidance on how budget is spent locally. And we believe the best route for that is for the new national body, the leadership group, to be a budget holding organisation, which can either through an innovation fund model or funding directly against local actions, can fund local partners directly, and that money is tracked and the projects are evaluated and the learning shared.
Thank you very much. Dan Proverbs.
Just to obviously agree with what the guys have said. I think it does need to be ring-fenced. I think it needs to... But also, I within that, you can't rely on third sector charities to be doing. You know, there's got to be, again, speaking from my point of view, from male mental health and suicide, there's got to be funds that's allocated towards that. You can't just rely on us as a charity trying to raise the funds ourselves to combat this.
Thank you. Scott Walker.
So again, in agreement, yes to a budget, yes to this time scale, but I'd also put in place that, you know, it's got to be compulsory delivery across the whole of Scotland. I wouldn't want it just to be seen to be targeted at any specific areas or any areas to lose out. You know, this is a challenge that the whole of Scotland faces, so we need to see action across the entire landmass of Scotland.
Okay. Toni.
Just to finish on the point that I think we have a real opportunity here to bring suicide prevention back on the political agenda. And we can do that. We're able to do that by creating a new national body that can lead that step change, that can bring that leadership. And
with the strategic plan, including funding and timescales.
Absolutely. Resource, teeth and resource.
Excellent. Thank you very much, gentlemen. That's been a very thorough evidence session. We will now adjourn for 5 minutes and then resume in private session. Let's say at 16 minutes past 12.